Check, check, y'all. We out here. Greenlining Institute, now and next speaker series. It begins now, y'all. It begins now. See you, Jane.
Come on,
clap your hands, y'all. Let's go. You are in the right place, y'all. Greenlining Institute, now and next speaker series. It is 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, 1 p.m. in the East Coast. Let us know in the chat where you're from. I know we got people all over the country here. This is the second of a three-part series. Great to see y'all with us today. It's a beautiful day, kind of hot in some parts of the country, and it's all good. We'll make it through it. Good morning, good midday, good afternoon, y'all. We got people, Alameda County, what's that? Come on, Ohlone Land.
Once again, it's on. It's been a while since you heard the style. Yes, it took a little time, but now we work your while. So I'm a view from my crew.
What's up, Kayla?
So long, this track cat off that a national naughty bomb. The Hilltown party rhyme sayer. Depleting them seeds like the ozone layer. May acquire my desires in like vintage wine. We shall sell no rhyme before it's time. The 1999 MC, microphone controller, master of ceremonies. So remember why you hate me. I'm naughty by nature, you're severed by association. Which meaning that you fake, connected to them snakes.
What's up, Brandon?
Don't come up in my plate. You trying to keep on rhyming like you didn't know. Naughty by nature came to save you from them.
He came in a party, yeah. Together, everybody.
What's up, Rayshawn? Good to see you on here. What's up, Kim? That's right, y'all. Greenlining Institute, now and next speaker series. Today, I open my eyes to a brilliant new day of light and love. I focus on my highest good in everything I do. I will maintain peace and harmony within my inner being and not allow outside circumstances to disturb my happiness. No, I won't. I honor my sacred life and I am grateful, grateful for all that I have. You're in the right place, y'all. We're gonna get started in just a couple minutes. Good morning, good midday, good afternoon.
We like the breeze, flow straight out of our lips. Them, they got boo bodies, hard rock Brooklyn kids. Us, floor rush, when they DJ booming classics. You think the crew on the fattest hip-hop record. He touched the kinks and sinks into the sounds. She frequents deep, fatter joints called undergrounds. Our funk zooms like you hit the Mary. They flock to booms, man, boogie had to change.
Hey!
Who freaks the clips with mad amount percussion? Where kinky hair goes to unthought of dimensions?
Good why morning, so Hannah!
Hip hop got some drama. When butterfly rock the light, you sway boomers.
What's up, Karen?
We push it off the corner. How was the buzz entire hip hop era? Was fresh and fat since they started saying Audi? Cause funk's made fat from right beneath my hood. The pooba of the styles like Miles, my man. Like 60s funky worms with waves and perms. Just sending junky rhythms right down your block. We beat to rap, what key beat to lock?
Cause I'm cool like that, yes.
I'm cool like that. I'm cool like that. I'm cool like that.
Come on, Carolyn.
I'm cool like that. I'm cool like that.
Y'all in the right place. Good morning. May the blessings of this day radiate through your smile, be helpful through your hands, and shine through your heart. Everybody clap. Let me hear you in the chat.
Just like Jesus.
Come on.
The water into wine.
Bring your emojis on. Let us know you're ready, y'all.
Just like Jesus.
Come on.
Yeah.
Put your horns up. Let's go, Lolly.
Hold up, y'all. Woo. Let me hit a hook. Hey.
Come on, Greenlining.
Oh, that feel good right there.
How y'all feeling?
Bring the whole band in right here, like.
Yeah. We got our hands clapping. That's what I'm talking about.
Here we go.
Thank you for being here with us today, y'all.
Oh, it's a party now.
Let's go, Alice. Come on. Amanda, where you at?
Let's go. Make all things new. Makes all things new. Yeah,
where you
remember
at?
Not the fault, but things they are through.
Come on, Lexi. Yeah. Come on, Andy.
Old you was through. New you.
Get up. Yeah. We out here, y'all. When everything seems to be going against you, remember that the airplane takes off against the wind, not with it. Let's go.
Tell me.
Get up.
Yeah. Time to get up.
We're so happy you're here with us. Greenlining Institute, now a next speaker series. I'm going to pass it over to Debra Gore-Mann. Show some love to Debra, y'all. Show some love.
Good morning and afternoon and evening, wherever you are at. Love you, DJ Omay. They always bring us the energy. So welcome. We're going to get started in the event shortly. But before we do that, let's do a quick walkthrough on today's platform. If you have any tech issues, your best bet is to just refresh your page or send a direct message to additional support staff who's standing by. Also, all of our sessions will be recorded and available to all registered participants shortly after the event. So be on the lookout for that. And we're happy if you can share that after you've been through this wonderful event that we have planned for you today. And also, we have time for a couple of questions from the audience towards the end of the event. So please submit your questions by clicking over to the Q&A tab and just start typing. So again, thank you so much for being here and welcome to Greenlining Institute's three-part speaker series, Now and Next, The State of Race Today and Tomorrow. This is our second event titled, How Has Redlining Persisted into the Modern Day? Now, before we get started, I have a quick update. Unfortunately, Yashima Bate Milner of Black Data for Black Lives, who was scheduled to attend, is no longer able to join us. But we have an exciting lineup and the conversation is gonna be off the hook. Let me start. My name is Debbie Gore-Mann, and I'm the president and CEO of the Greenlining Institute. I joined Greenlining in 2019, right before the start of COVID. Now, here we are 2.5 years later, still coping with the pandemic. What we've witnessed first and foremost was the singular driving issue was racial inequity. Race, more than any other indicator, defined how you experienced the pandemic, our economy, and our society. Let me tell you a little bit about Greenlining Institute. We were founded in 1993 by a group of grassroots leaders from African American, Asian American, Latino, and disabled communities. We came together quite simply to fight discrimination and redlining and to bring investments and opportunity into our communities. At that time, they were building racial equity and greenlining. Even after 30 years, Greenlining now, our vision remains the same. We envision a future where communities of color can build wealth, live in healthy communities, economic opportunity, and be ready to meet the challenges of climate change with resilience and persistence. So before we transition to the speakers, we'd like to offer a land acknowledgement as well. Greenlining is located in Oakland, California, and today we acknowledge that we come to you on lands of forced removal of Indigenous people from the Ohlone, Muwekma, and Chokenio tribal lands. So let's talk about what we're going to hear and share today. So before the pandemic, internet access and data were imperfect, and there were good folks trying to make honest work and progress towards dealing with the shortcomings of the lack of infrastructure, technology, and concerns about existing data sets. Then COVID-19 hit us all, and the internet was fundamental and a necessity for just participating in modern life. Overnight, we sheltered in place. Remember, overnight, we shut down offices, storefronts, restricted the transportation, we closed banks, and so much more that it touched all of our personal lives. So our basic societal functions went digital. In the blink of the eye, we defined what essential work was, what essential spaces were. Huge disparities became evident. If you did not have access to internet or a decent device, then you could not go to school, go to work, see your doctor, schedule a COVID appointment, do your banking. Before COVID, also many people had a tendency to treat technology and data as maybe neutral or sterile or immune to people's failings, but not anymore. Terms like digital divide have been around a long time. Lots of folks used it to talk mostly about education, but now the digital divide means so much more. It's not just about who has access to the internet. It's about how big data and technology impacts everybody's life. Now, big data is everywhere. From your everyday apps, frankly, I gotta use my map to go anywhere, to complex algorithms. Technology has the potential to hide, speed, and deepen discrimination as well, while all the while appearing neutral and even benevolent when compared to sort of past racist practices. So in this session, how has redlining persisted into the modern day? We will share an understanding of how structural racism informs our technology and the data it gathers and uses. So with that, let me introduce our panelists. First, Dr. Dominique Harrison is the director of Citi Ventures, Citi Ventures Innovations Racial Equity Design and Data Initiative. Woo, REDDI, y'all, where she is pioneering technology-led practices and solutions for reducing bias and promoting equity for people in communities of color. She works with a multidisciplinary team. Prior to Citi Ventures, Dominique led numerous projects at the intersection of equity, technology, and public policies, issues affecting Black communities at the Joint Center for Political and Economic Study. I love that name, the Joint Center. It's like I'm hanging out at the joint. She also worked at the Aspen Digital Program at the Aspen Institute. We are excited to welcome Dominique to speak on how we can rebuild the tech ecosystem to address the challenges of diversity, equity, and inclusion. Welcome, Dominique. Also, Mandita Sampath is a policy analyst at Consumer Reports, located in San Francisco. Mandita advocates for changes in the US law to fight algorithmic discrimination and pseudoscience issues in AI. Her area of focus is algorithmic bias and accountability issues, helping Consumer Reports shape its platform in this emerging area of policy. Prior to joining Consumer Report, she was an engineer in Silicon Valley. She has previously worked at tech policy groups such as Center for Democracy and Technology, ID 2020, and UC Berkeley's Citrus Policy Lab. Welcome, Nandita. And our very own Vincent Lay, who is our legal counsel with our economic equity team here at the Greenlining Institute. Vincent serves on several regulatory boards, including the California Privacy Protection Agency. He leads Greenlining's work to close the digital divide, protect consumer privacy, ensure algorithms are fair, and that technology builds economic opportunity for communities of color. Welcome, Vincent. Okay, let's jump in. Okay, we think of redlining as a thing of the past, but in reality, the legacy of redlining lives on today. It's ambitious, but we're going to outline both the digital divide and algorithmic bias and show the audience how it's shaping our world and our future today. So can we get grounded in some terms first? Dominique, you wrote a powerful report while at the Joint Center titled Affordability and Availability. Oh, I'm getting a little bit of feedback. Expanding broadband in the Black Neutral South. Can you define digital divide for our audience and why it's so important to address this issue now?
Yes, thank you so much. Happy to be here, Debbie. Really appreciate the opportunity to talk about these topics. So the research was really important for us while I was at the Joint Center. You know, we noticed that efforts to close the digital divide often overlooked Black residents of rural communities. And conversations that focused on the digital divide often conflated rural with white. And so we wanted to dig deeper into the issue and to really understand how Black communities in the rural areas of the United States were faring as it related to access to the internet. So the digital divide can be understood as the gap between those with internet access and those without it. Now, some people might say, well, everyone has the internet because everyone has a phone. But while many people can use the internet on their phone, it's a totally different experience of doing work, attending school, or receiving telehealth services, which is much more strenuous on a phone as opposed to internet at home, which is referred to as broadband. The digital divide is especially pronounced among those who are low income, the elderly, LGBTQIA+ communities, and those who live in rural areas. So in the report, we looked at what we define as the Black Rural South, and we talked about the potential for broadband to increase economic, educational, and healthcare opportunities for those individuals. At the Joint Center, the Black Rural South was defined as 152 rural counties across 10 states in the South with populations that are at least 35% Black. And, you know, what we learned, as you've mentioned, Debbie, is that if the pandemic has taught us anything, it is that broadband is especially important. When schools were forced to close because of that pandemic, 74% of the 100 largest school districts chose remote learning as their only institutional educational model. However, students without broadband, particularly those who live within lower income households, could not participate in remote learning or complete their homework. And during the height of the pandemic, many healthcare providers provided free telemedicine services, such as virtual medical visits for people with no health insurance. And the use of telehealth increased from 11% in 2019 to 46% in May 2020. With doctors seeing close to 175 times the number of patients they would have before the pandemic. So there's a lot more in the report that highlights the importance of these issues, but these are just some of the kind of facts that, you know, lead to the importance of addressing the digital divide today and in the future.
Thank you. Yeah, that was really helpful, and especially that data is so compelling, right? We're going to be talking about data and how to use it for good and how it can be used in negative ways. So thank you for grounding us in those terms. Nandita, you authored a white paper called The Future of Public Sector Work, where you talked about human-centered technology. Can you define for us, you know, just the basics here to get us started, algorithmic bias, and the way you're using the term human-centered technology?
Yeah, hi, good to be here. So I think coming from both a tech background and a policy background, there isn't actually a ton of consensus on these terms or the definitions of these terms, but I'm just gonna define them the way that I think about them. So an algorithm is just a process that a computer follows to make a decision. And that's sometimes used interchangeably with artificial intelligence or machine learning. And AI is essentially just using a ton of historical data to make predictions about future data points. So you can think of using historical data about weather patterns to make predictions about what the weather might look like next year, which may not be applicable due to climate change at this point, but that's generally how it works. So algorithmic bias is when there's a lot of points at, in the algorithmic design process that can contribute to bias and discrimination. But in general, kind of one of the main ways that happens is when the data that the algorithm is being fed is skewed. And so that could be an over-representation or an under-representation of certain demographics that could lead to biased outcomes for them. So an example of over-representation of a particular group is when you think about trying to use, if a law enforcement wants to use an algorithm to predict crime patterns in certain areas, Black communities tend to be over-policed. And so a lot of the data from those communities tends to be overrepresented in a sample. And so that might indicate to law enforcement to continue to police certain areas. And that just kind of creates a positive feedback loop, which can be very harmful for communities. An example of underrepresentation, which is actually just a euphemism for historical exclusion, in my opinion, is if you think about an algorithm looking at a bunch of job applications, like if they're reading through resumes or they're there's cases of companies being able to analyze how the way someone talks in a job interview and kind of put them through the next round in a job application process. If those applicants don't look like who has historically been successful in jobs, so for example, in the tech industry, tends to be very white and male. You know, if you're a woman or you're a different ethnic group, and there is some indication on your resume that shows that you're different from like resumes that have been historically successful, that algorithm might screen you out. And so that's an example of underrepresentation in a data set. And so human-centered technology, I think, is also kind of a bit of a nebulous term. But for me, especially coming from Consumer Reports, we think about things from a consumer perspective. The difference between using algorithms these days and other technology we've thought about in the past is often the person using the algorithm isn't the one that's primarily affected by it. And so you can think of using Amazon Ring, for example, that's the camera that you can put on next to your doorbell that kind of surveils your neighborhood. The person buying the product isn't the one being surveilled by the product. And so we have to think about all the stakeholders involved in decision-making when designing products. And so that often isn't, the end user and the consumer are not always the same in those cases. And so we just have to think about who's going to be affected by it. We have to provide them ways to give input into decision-making when designing a product. And sometimes that means we shouldn't be building things at all, but that's not always the way that companies go about designing products. And so we just have to be more careful of that going forward.
Thank you. Yeah, I think that's right. The terms are fluid, like you were saying. It depends on who you ask is a different answer you will get. But thank you for grounding us in algorithms, algorithmic bias, and the human-centered nature of technology. So Vincent, you also wrote an excellent report called Algorithmic Bias Explained, where you did the ABCs in that report as well. And your goal, though, was to help advocates and policy makers develop a baseline understanding of that bias and the impact that relates to socioeconomic opportunities. I mean, there were just some great storytelling in there, so I appreciate that. So can you, in particular, share with us some of those direct economic impacts of the algorithmic bias on communities of color and how it exacerbates the racial wealth gap? And that'll get us into this conversation.
Yeah, so you know, we talk about a lot of different examples in that report, but essentially the through line was that you know a lot of these biased algorithmic systems, automated decision systems, essentially deny communities of color the opportunities we need to close the racial wealth gap. That means paying more for loans, getting worse medical care, even though you're sicker than a white patient, getting worse job opportunities because your resume has your last name on it, or it says that you kind of indicates your gender or your race. You get more predatory advertising and products. And you know, essentially, we see a lot of the same barriers that created the racial wealth gap in the first place. Two quick examples that actually came out after the report, so this is kind of new, is that there was a study showing that Black applicants for home mortgage loans were 50 to 120% more likely to be denied for those mortgages than white applicants with the same credit score, right? So that's just redlining part two. And, you know, another example that came out, this time from the Netherlands, was a government agency was using an algorithm to scan, you know, their residents for tax fraud, right? They were getting childcare benefits to help them, you know, go to work and make a career. And essentially the algorithm would flag people that weren't Dutch, right? They had different citizenship status as more likely to commit fraud. So that meant 26,000 families were accused wrongly of making, you know, fraudulent benefit claims, and they were forced to pay back those loans, right? So these families were denied benefits that other people were able to get, and then in so denied the opportunity to, you know, advance in their career. And it worse, they were punished wrongly by this algorithm. So there's a lot of examples to see if these algorithms are designed wrongly, then that can actually impact, you know, our ability to succeed and build a healthy, wealthy life, you know, in the United States and beyond.
Yeah, I appreciate that international example. So it's not just a U.S. problem, right? We think of racism and white supremacy as one of our original sins in this country, but these algorithmic biases can be used in multiple ways. So thanks for you all grounding us in these terms. But I think would be really interesting to hear what brought you and the organization that you're at to this technology bias work, and how are you making meaning from the work? So Dominique, in your work, you aim to find technology-led practices and solutions of reducing bias and promoting equity. Can you just share with us your journey a bit?
Yes, absolutely. First, can you hear me clearly?
Yeah, got you. Loud and clear.
Okay, perfect. Great. Well, great question. I mean, you know, let me just say that, you know, throughout my career, it has always been my passion to be advocating on behalf of communities, particularly Black communities, as it relates to topics of media and technology. And so for the last few years, you know, I've worked in the nonprofit think tank space, thinking about these issues, but also about the kind of legislation that can address these challenges. That's very important. I think research is important, but also solutions that make it imperative for leaders, organizations, or people to put things in place to have equitable outcomes. And so, you know, after working at the Joint Center, which I enjoyed immensely, you know, I saw an opportunity where I actually got to apply many of the ideas, strategies, and practices that I advocated for as a leader in the nonprofit think tank space within a private company and within a bank, really. And, you know, after the murders of George Floyd and others, you know, many institutions and organizations pledged to, you know, give money, develop programs, and new strategies. And so our team, although the idea had come much earlier than that, was really formalized during that time. And so, you know, it's really exciting work that I'm able to do in terms of leading a group of folks who are expert in research, design, and data. And as a team, we think deeply about how to apply an equity-centered approach to the research and design of Citi's products and services with the aim to center the needs and wants and aspirations of Black and Latinx community. And so an equity-centered approach in financial services can be designing inclusive digital experiences and access to a product or a service. Two, it can mean implementing data and responsible AI or machine learning tools that increase financial inclusion and economic mobility for specific consumers. But it could also mean developing financial product solutions that remove barriers and provide opportunities for Black and Latinx communities to access services, for example, like lowering account fees or balance requirements, or providing more branches or ATMs in those communities. So as a team, you know, we're working hard to share these insights and strategies with our colleagues across the bank, because we think this work is really important as it relates to embedding racial equity as a business standards. We also create original kind of research and tools and resources for our colleagues to think deeply about these topics.
So I'm going to stay with you a little bit here, Dominique. I mean, as a Black and brown women, and for me, I identify as woman, as female. What are the challenges that, you know, first, what got you into this sort of very, you know, technical but impactful space. And what's your experience been like trying to navigate? You know, sometimes I could imagine you being in rooms that are different than you. And so what is that personal connection of why you do the work and what it's like you being in that space doing the work?
Yeah, so good question. I mean, in high school, I'd always participated in groups and organizations that were trying to do some kind of social good for specific communities. In undergrad, I focused my studies on like representation of Black and Brown folks in TV and in the media and why that matters so much in terms of seeing yourself in those spaces. In my PhD program, you know, I focused on access to broadband specifically for Jamaican women and girls, because access to the internet is a different kind. There comes up with different issues across international communities as it relates to the challenges and opportunities those folks have. But it was really my experience in being exposed to the plethora of technological topics and equity at the Aspen Institute that got me to learn more about the different spaces and ways in which technology has negative opportunities or outcomes for Black communities. And so I learned more about the AI space, more about privacy, competition, content moderation. I mean, all of these topics, you know, sometimes don't really focus on Black and Brown communities or Asian communities as well, or Indigenous. And so it takes folks like us who are advocates to really think deeply about those specific needs that we're experiencing. You know, throughout my career, I mean, especially coming into the private industry, you know, one of the things that I've faced as a challenge, I think, is that when you are going to be innovative and when you are going to have new ideas and new ways of thinking, you're a disruptor. And many people are not as open yet to that disruption, or, you know, are scared of this new way of thinking and doing. And so there's a lot of questionings or lack of understanding and trying new ways of doing work. And so, you know, as a Black woman, I, you know, try my best to advocate for the topics that are important that I'm focused on. But as you keep on talking, you realize that you get more buy-in from people and people want to work with you. So the experience has been good in terms of the work that we're doing at Citi. And we've gotten a lot of teammates who have reached out to us just wanting to learn more about what we do and how we can collaborate.
Yes, thank you for that insight into how you're doing the work. And Nadita, you were in some unique spaces too, because you were an electrical engineer. So that alone is going to put you in, you know, you're going to be one of when you show up in a room, and computer science on top of that. But then you got your master's in public policy, and now you're doing this AI policy work at Consumer Report. So share with us, you know, that sort of path and what your experience has been like doing this work and advocating as you do.
Sure. So I started off as an engineering major in college, and I think that was around the time where a lot of issues started popping up with Facebook and some of the privacy issues on those platforms, and also just kind of the beginnings of the indicators of polarization and all of that, that these platforms tend to kind of perpetuate. And so to be honest, like, I think a lot of engineering schools don't do a great job of incorporating ethics into the curriculum. And I was really frustrated with that at the time, because I did want to use my degree as an engineer, but I also didn't find a lot of the companies that I could work at were like cared too much about that. And so I did end up working as an engineer briefly after college, but I was at an 8-person startup, and we didn't once talk about like the impacts of what we were working on. And I think that's just like indicative of like the broader culture in Silicon Valley and tech companies in general, where people just like building things because they're technically very interesting and cool, but they're like not really thinking about who they affect and, you know, ways to mitigate harm during the design process. So as kind of like very immediately after I started working as an engineer, I was like, I can't do this anymore. I want to think about how to regulate this stuff. And so I decided to go to policy school. So I went back to get my master's, and I actually didn't plan on focusing on AI when I started my master's. I was really interested in privacy, but I just had a lot of AI projects kind of thrown at me. It was kind of the hot thing at the time, like 4 or 5 years ago. And so, it ended up being a really good use of my technical background, and also just like my interest in regulation. And I think I just I have some authority issues, and I think I just get really mad when companies are manipulating people, and that just like lights a fire in me. So it just ended up being a good use of my skills. And then I lucked out as soon as I graduated and got a job at Consumer Reports. So at CR, we're AI is like a pretty new area for us. We've done a lot of, we obviously are known for our product reviews, and we've done
right.
a lot of testing on privacy and security in the past, but AI products are like a new space for us. And so, as I mentioned before, like we've had to kind of expand our definition of consumer because the person buying the product is not always the person who's affected by the product. And so that's just kind of like a whole new ball game. We do have to think about like, all right, we do have to think about ethics for like how to design it and like who's purchasing it, but then also like who's affected by this? Like, how do we mitigate the harm that is unintentional because the person using this isn't the person that's like being surveilled? And so, yeah, it's been difficult, but I think, you know, we're really excited about this new area. We have like a growing tech policy team. So we're just trying to get involved with as much legislation as possible, thinking about like good design practices, and then also just how to test kind of like a new set of products, which is something that we haven't done before.
Thank you. Thank you. And you didn't luck out. You were qualified. Vincent, so I love this quote in your report where it said, we find it important to state that the benefits of any technology should be felt by all of us. And it goes on to say, too often the challenges presented by new technologies spell out yet another tale of racism, sexism, gender inequality, ableism, and a lack of consent with the digital culture. And that was Mimi Anoha. So you have your JD, you're an attorney, you worked in the public defender's office and then SBA. What brought you to this work and now in particular, this expertise that you're building out?
Yeah, you know, I think I like Nandita, you know, came in with a, you know, interest in, well, broadband as well as privacy. And, you know, I think I quickly learned, that, you know, it's not just privacy, it's these AI systems. It's like, what happens with that data? After, you know, we've given away our privacy, we've given away our data, that gets fed into these algorithms. And, you know, at first I actually thought, you know, AI, this is the way that we can fix bias, right? It's like, there's no humans involved, like it's computers are objective. We can just code out all of these problems that we have, right? And, you know, very quickly, you know, reading, the People's Guide to AI, you know, Weapons of Mass Destruction, Automating Inequality, I was like, oh no, it's actually recreating the redlining of the past, but they're doing it at more scale with less oversight in a lot of ways. And, you know, I think I was a little bit horrified because I was kind of pitching to the organization Greenlining. I was like, hey, this is the way we can fix a lot of things. And very quickly after, you know, I pitched it to Greenlining, I was like, actually, no, there's a lot of regulations. There's a lot of work that we need to do before we can get to the point, right, where, you know, AI can actually, you know, live up to that promise of eliminating, you know, unjust decisions, unfair, discriminatory ones. So,
yeah. So true. Let's now thank you all for sharing your backgrounds, how you got to this work. I think you hit on a lot of really good topics. And Nandita, let me go back to you. What are these barriers that Vincent sort of touched on of implicit and explicit bias that impact AI at this point?
Yeah, so I think the main issue is just an overall lack of transparency about how this stuff works. And so as a end user of an algorithm, you might not even know that you're being discriminated against. As I mentioned with these like hiring algorithms, if you're rejected by an algorithm that's analyzing your resume, you might not know that the algorithm is being discriminatory or is allowing someone else to pass that has similar experience to you, but looks different from you or like is from a different demographic. And so I think that's kind of one of the big issues is the victims of algorithmic discrimination don't know that this is happening at all. And I think that's related to the issue of just a lack of transparency with the public and regulators don't, I think they get a little bit scared of this stuff because it is complicated, but I think it's also, a lot of it is companies kind of overstating the accuracy and the capabilities of their technology as well. And I think that also kind of gets regulators a bit like, oh, this is like a little bit too complicated. Like, we don't really know how to deal with this. But a lot of the times AI companies are actually just using like pretty standard and like simpler statistical methods that have been around for a long time that aren't necessarily like AI or like, you know, complicated algorithms. And so I think that kind of creates a barrier too. And then I think also just there's no transparency requirements for like the data collection process. Like what data are companies using to make decisions about you? Like how is each data point factoring into a decision? How are they mitigating their bias during the testing process? Like, we just don't know how these companies are doing that. And there's not really requirements for companies to disclose that information. And I think one thing that we think about a lot at Consumer Reports is the issue of snake oil in AI. And so that's kind of just, like I mentioned, companies overstating the capabilities of their products. We can think about, there's a lot of companies that are creating like emotion recognition. So they claim that they can identify your emotions based on your face. And they use that for job analyzing you if you're capable of like being competent in a job. So they'll use that in the hiring process. And the way that you talk and the way that you look aren't related to your capabilities or your ability to do a job well. And so there's just a lot of these sorts of products that use data that are unrelated to the actual final decision. And so, but they claim that they are related. And so there's just a lot of kind of misinformation out there on how these products work, like what they're capable of doing. And I think we do have laws that kind of prohibit discrimination in various sectors, but it's kind of the lack of enforcement and the lack of guidelines to industry in terms of, you know, what they're able to claim and what they're capable of doing is just needs more regulation and guidance at this point.
Yeah, I think we've pointed out just in this early part. Oh, Dominique, is there something you want to add?
Yeah, just really quickly that you know, I'm continuing to learn more about what's being called the data divide, which relates to, you know, many of the things that Nandita spoke about in terms of the lack of data about specific community members, which helps determine, you know, specific services or programs that would be beneficial for those communities. I mean, we know how important data is in being able to understand what's going on with our world, but also to make decisions at a faster, much more kind of better rate than a human might be able to. But the lack of data about specific communities is becoming a challenge in being able to provide more services and programs, or even publicly available data that different institutions or organizations like the ones we represent can test with to understand what are the needs and perspectives of specific consumers. So I just wanted to drop that in there as something that I know the government is working on, but also a topic in that is of interest to the communities that we care about. And at the same time, we must juggle with the other the challenges of access to our private information that can lead to privacy concerns, et cetera.
Yeah, no, it reminds me of when they started to show the research that the facial recognition wasn't working on darker toned hued people. And then I think it was Google who hired some consultants to go get racial recognition of people of color, and they went to homeless people so they wouldn't have to pay them. And then, you know, it was just perpetuating a racist sort of process of how to expand that data. Well, let me say with you then, Dominique, on so what does that fairness look like? You know, what does fairness in the data or in, frankly, the access to the affordability, the adoption, some of the things you highlighted before, what does fairness, transparency, and accountability sort of look like from your perspective?
Yeah, so when I think about broadband and in terms of those themes as it relates to that, you know, fairness in broadband looks like all communities, despite geographic location, income levels of neighborhoods and race, having the choice to access high speed, affordable, home internet service. Transparency looks like consumers having all the information on pricing, rates, speeds, and data to make the best decision on broadband services that meet their need. Transparency also includes better mapping or accurate data to pinpoint where broadband service is available and where it is not, because there are conflicting data points that have been developed by our government and by private companies. Accountability includes holding companies accountable for service and deploying in all communities, again, despite the geographic location or the income levels of neighborhoods. You know, many governments and nonprofit institutions have developed equity plans over the past 2 years on the distribution of services and programs for communities. But companies should also be willing to develop equity plans for how they are progressing and providing equitable access to broadband services for all communities. And when I think about data, I think that comes with a lot, a different set of kind of issues or opportunities. But at the end of the day, it's important for consumers to understand what information is being collected about them, mm-hmm. how it is being used, right? And what kind of guardrails companies or institutions are putting in place to protect that information. People of color especially have to deal with issues as it relates to their information being exposed, their private information. And there's a long history as it relates to any ways of surveillance of Black and Brown communities across the U.S. And so these are just some of the things that I think about when I think about, you know, ways to progress and providing more accountability on that topic.
Yeah. And Vincent, let me bring you in here, especially on this topic of fairness. I know, having hung out with you a little bit, you know, that we were both really excited when you got on the California Private Protection Agency, because there's this fairness that we are seeking here at Greenlining for our community and access. Can you give your perspective on how you've been approaching it in some of those spaces, those regulatory spaces that you're in?
Yeah, I think, it'll be up to the agency to decide what those final rules are. But, you know, as far as I see it, you know, I think what I want to see from companies on the fairness side of things is, what do they define as fair, right? There's an ask of like, well, maybe the government should define what is fair, and they provide guidance. And in some cases, the government does. But I think at this stage, given the capacity of so many regulatory agencies, we don't know how each company is approaching fairness. Why don't you just write it down, right, and share it? Like, what is a fair decision to you, right? And then from there, we can make a decision as a society, as a regulator, around, hey, no, actually, this isn't very fair, right? So that's just the general approach that I think I'm in favor of. And, you know, I just on this other point around fairness, I think one interesting thing that the Greenlining Institute has been exploring, right, is about race-aware algorithms, right? And the potential of that to make more fair decisions. So for the most part, a lot of automated decision systems algorithms today are race blind, right? They don't get your racial data, so they can claim like, hey, we don't know your race, so there's no way we can be discriminating. But when in fact, like, they have enough information. They have your last name, they have your zip code, they have what you purchase, all of the what websites you visit. So there's a very good knowledge, at least, of proxies for race. So I don't really think that race-blind approach makes sense. And I think companies should potentially gather this racial, ethnic, gender data, right? And maybe you don't have to use it in making the decisions, but using that to test your results to see, okay, were they fair? Is there a discriminatory difference between the decisions? And if so, can that be explained in a legal way? If not, then you got to go back to the drawing board and redesign that algorithm. And the second way is, you know, a little bit more controversial, we'd have to change a lot of our laws, is using that race data, making a decision, because we know that arrest rates are different between Black and white people, even though they're committing the same crimes. We know that SAT scores are more predictive for college success for white students than Black students. So in algorithm, using that data, if it could address, it could know someone's race, and they can be like, oh, arrest maybe doesn't mean as much for this person than this person because of those different rates, maybe we can come to a more fair decision. So that's, you know, there's a lot. I would love to talk about that in the future, but it's a very interesting area of where we can move fair AI decisions.
Yeah, and compelling. Okay, so let's now talk about some solutions, you guys. What are solutions to consider, like when we're thinking about technology, big data, algorithms? And in Greenlining, you know, we take an inside-outside approach. There's advocacy and movement and coalition building, putting outside pressure, and then there's the inside, those of us who are working inside of private companies or the industries and elected officials. Let's move into some of those solutions. So Nandita, in our experience advancing legislation to regulate algorithmic decision making, we've learned a lot about the complexity that you all have pointed out here. Can you talk about your experience in advancing? You touched on it a little bit earlier when we were talking about your career path. What are you experiencing in advancing these policies that look more like solutions?
Yeah, so I think the legislative landscape of algorithms is still like very early. We're still kind of at the stage where we're just trying to kind of provide more transparency to the public and regulators about how this stuff works. And so I've seen a lot of bills, and I'm sure Vincent can also elaborate because he's worked on this stuff, where the main kind of mechanism to do that is called an algorithmic impact assessment. There's various terms for it, but that's one of the names for it. And so that would essentially require companies to provide to agencies or the public, the data they collect for their algorithms, how they've tested their algorithms, how they've gone about mitigating bias, how each data point factors into decisions. And that's kind of the main stage we're at this point, is just like, how does this stuff work? How do we provide regulators more information? And then from there, we can start thinking about how to actually regulate and kind of clamp down on some of the harms. But that's what I've seen the most often at this point. And so there are other bills and laws out there that are trying to prohibit the use of AI and algorithms in certain cases. So I've seen in Washington State, there was a bill, I think earlier this year or last year, where they were trying to prohibit the use of algorithms to make decisions about people's access to life opportunities when the government is using algorithms. And so that was an interesting one because they're essentially acknowledging that a lot of these algorithms are pretty flawed and like have pretty, like the accuracy rates aren't high enough essentially. And so if someone is denied a basic service like access to food stamps or public housing, like, and they're denied that wrongly, like that's not good enough. And so we should just not use algorithms to make those decisions. I've seen certain other cases of, I think Illinois has a law where they have to provide a job applicant notice, like a company has to provide them notice if they're using algorithms to make a decision about their application during the hiring process. Hmm. But in general, I've seen a lot of legislation that is, in my opinion, a little bit redundant because they're essentially trying to prohibit the use of discriminatory algorithms in particular sectors, but we already do have a lot of anti-discrimination law. And so I think what that just means is we need better enforcement. We just need the FTC and the EEOC, like all these federal and state agencies, to kind of crack down on the use of algorithms in harmful decision making. And so, as I mentioned, snake oil is a big issue for us. And so the FTC is in charge of enforcing against unfair and deceptive practices. And so that's what we think about a lot, is like, are these algorithms claiming things that aren't possible? And so if so, like the FTC needs to do something about it. And I think a lot of the issues with agencies enforcing these bills and these laws is that there just isn't a ton of funding and staff to do that. And so I think one of the ways to fix that is to prioritize that more in government, like provide these agencies with more resources to go about enforcing these laws better.
Yes, fundamentally, they need to staff it. They need to staff it with diverse opinions and diverse folks, and we need to fund it, so for sure. Dominique, I know you have been doing your early work so far with Citi Ventures, and the work group is so interesting, Racial Equity Design and Data Initiative. And then you focus on the innovative disruptive part. So what are some of the solutions and opportunities that you're seeing coming, percolating up from the private sector that's leaning into some of these disruptive practices?
Yeah, so I mean, some of the solutions that we have talked through as a team and really trying to understand deeply to be able to share that across the bank is, one of the first things I'm recognizing is that, again, as it relates to the data divide, there is a lack of want or desire to collect data on race and ethnicity. And that's important in an effort to understand, again, the perspectives of consumers and their experiences with specific products and services and how these technologies may be impacting them. Banking, there's a lot of regulation. And I think there is, there's fear that if we collect race, then we'll be accused of doing something wrong. On the other hand, I think there is guidance from specific federal institutions in how to collect it in ways to understand the needs of those specific consumers. And that's important to the things that we're building and that we're selling. So another kind of solution that I see is that intentionally designing for system change and not just individual behavior change, right? I mean, I think often when folks come to these issues or discussions on this topic, it's a matter of what people are not doing and the bad behavior that communities may have, when we should actually be focused on the system that has created this kind of historical exclusion, as Nandita shared earlier, right? And so how can we change the ecosystem and the things that we, the institutions that are creating these kind of strategies and policies that are not having equitable outcomes to make change. Another solution is, you know, simply designing products that meet the needs and wants and aspirations of diverse communities. So that means you need to go out into the community and actually talk to people.
That's right.
Giving people agency and control over their financial desires and needs, right? There's not just one end goal for all people and what financial health may be for them, but we need to give agency to those folks who have different kind of aspirations. And one of the important things that's important to me in the work that I'm doing is really partnering with nonprofit leaders and diverse higher educational institutions to think deeply about how to address these issues throughout the educational ecosystem. I think we need to be working together and talking to different people to ideate on what is working and what's not. Let's share best practices. I think we all need the information to do our work better, but also to be serving communities and communities in better ways.
Thank you. Thank you. And we've got a few more minutes here and we want to pivot to some of the questions, but there are some other cool concepts that I think, there's some folks doing some work on a data dividend project, the fact that we should be compensated for that data and community collective data, you know, which creates some of the solutions that you are talking about seem fairly creative as well. So let me grab one of the questions from our audience. And thank you for those who have sent them in. And we will continue. We might be able to get to all the questions, but we'll continue the conversation in our social media. So follow us and our panelists on LinkedIn, Instagram, and Twitter. So the first question I'll throw out to you all, and just jump in. What do you all think we should simply be abolitionist about? What is not worth reforming that we should just get rid of? Surveillance, maybe, safety narrative, anybody. What should we just truly be an abolitionist about? Go ahead.
I mentioned earlier emotion recognition. That's just, there's no basis for that in science. And
that just sounds strange.
Yeah. And there's like a lot of historical, like kind of racism surrounding that. And so, I just think, you know, the way people express their emotions is very culturally dependent. And just because you're feeling something on the inside doesn't mean it's showing on your face. And so people are very kind of, they're using that to make really kind of life opportunity decisions about you, whether you're qualified for a job, like, how, you know, and that's just not okay. And I think that needs to stop.
Yep. Other ideas, Vincent or Dominique?
I think social credit scores. I don't know if you've seen that episode of Black Mirror where everyone has like a number on their head of like, you know, how good of a citizen they are. But, you know, we're seeing versions of that overseas. And I just think it's kind of terrifying to have all the information around you collated, put together, and then you can just be judged on the content of your data and not yourself. So I just, that one really creeps me out. And that's what I would second the abolition of.
You know, not to be a cynic, but, you know, the first thing that came to me was like freedom, you know. At the end of the day, you know, speaking as myself, as Dominique, you are not free if we cannot have access to public services, if I don't have choice in the desires of what I have and need as a person, a community member of the United States. And so we need to continue to advocate in places where we see that we don't have equal access and we don't have the opportunity to make the best decisions for our lives and our children and our family in America. And I think I know there are a number of issues that we're dealing with within our community. And I think, you know, we take a piece of that and we figure out how we can address broadband access. We figure out how we can address, you know, more grocery stores and healthy food choices in our communities. It'll take some time, but I mean, there's just so much on the table, but that's what I think about. That's what came to mind.
Yes, 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 everybody. Okay, so let's wrap up our session. Let me just say some key takeaways. I'm so grateful that you all shared, Nandita, the need to put the responsibility of companies to conduct algorithmic impact assessments. Yes, impact assessments, right? That personally is probably going to be an aha moment for them. It's like, where are we having impact? So appreciate that you lifted that up. And that, you know, they may not even know they're discriminating because they don't have that lens into how their information impacts community. And Dominique, I appreciated this freedom. So this is actually part of my closing comments. So the idea of freedom and the freedom of movement and the freedom of accessibility and affordability is so pivotal. And the intentional designing of systems to change rather than focusing on sort of individual behaviors and simply talking to community, that centers greenlining all the time. And this, you know, you lifted up replicating the same barriers that are created is also very, very helpful that you shared that with us. So thank you all to the panelists for your insights. And audience, please remember to join and share our final session on September 22nd for our conversation on democracy. So this third event, which we are calling How Can We Democratize from the Group Up, features Alicia Garza, author of The Purpose of Power Principle, and she's the principal of the Black Future Labs, and also Tarso Luis Ramos, who is the executive director of Public Research Associates, who's been researching and challenging the U.S. right wing for over 25 years. So stay with us. We will also be doing DJ Ome will come back. There will be a networking session for folks to be able to network with each other and enjoy the music. But I want to give each panelist the opportunity to just give us some closing remarks. And let me frame it this way. If I gave you a magic technology algorithmic wand, what would you use it for? And to create sort of this new this positive freedom envisioned technology AI. So I'll give the wand to you first, Vincent, and then to you, Nandita, and I'll have you take us home, Dominique. So Vincent, you have your technology wand.
You know, I think if I had the technology wand, I would just be able to, I would just want to know what every company puts into their decision, right? What's fair?
You want to look in the black box.
I want to look into the black box. All right? I want to open it up and be like, what is this magic? And the reality is a lot of companies don't even know, right? But if I had that power, right? And there are people talking about, well, we have an AI to understand the AI. Well, maybe that's the solution, maybe not. But I want to see inside the black box.
And your wand, Nandita, what would the wand do for us?
I just think, you know, a lot of my job is kind of cracking down on AI. And so I don't often get to be like super positive about algorithms, but I think this is like one case where I see a lot of, I'm hopeful that AI can be used well in healthcare. I think it really depends, like for diagnostics in particular. I think there is some early kind of findings of racial disparity when trying to identify early detection of skin cancer and stuff. But I think if integrated into the diagnostic process in a way where it only augments a doctor's decision-making as opposed to replaces it, I think that can be really helpful and like, you know, hopefully save a lot of lives. But I think that has to be integrated into a process that's like safe and doesn't lead to like confirmation bias for the doctor, and can really only maybe just help them identify things they missed as opposed to replacing their decision-making essentially. So I'm hopeful for that. I hope we can see more of that in the future.
That's beautiful. Cause if you ain't got your health, what, you know, any of us who had family members who got COVID, once you were super sick, you were just like, nothing else really mattered. And so if you use the wand for that, that's some powerful stuff. Dominique, what would you do with your technology AI wand?
So I would, you know, like to see and give the opportunity more to Black and Brown communities to be builders, creators, and designers of technology. We're not just users, right? There are a lot of kind of innovative ideas that we have and our communities know about to, you know, really meet the needs of folks who look like us. And so that's what I would do, give more opportunities to those individuals to be creating new solutions for many of the challenges that we're dealing with today.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. So that kind of ties up our, and if you as panelists want to stick around and network with folks and hear from them and they can share their ideas and you can share, that would be outstanding. So it's wonderful that it really tied together our first session where we talked about solidarity and movement and creating the change we want to see. And now we're talking about the technology, the data that we produce to do that. So thank you for being part of our second session and being so insightful. And again, you all follow, you know, Vincent and Nandita and Dominique on their socials to keep in touch with this information. So with that, we will say thank you, everybody, for joining and stay with us with DJ Ome and the networking session, and hopefully see you September 22nd.
Thank you, Debra. Thank you to all of our panelists. By all means, make your way into the next space to connect with folks. You can stay here with me, your DJ Ome. Greenlining Institute. I'll be here for the next 20, 25 minutes for y'all. Come back and forth. All right, here. Let's go. Emoji claps. Let me know you're with me. Come on, Samantha. Three-part series. Next event, September 22nd. Greenlining. Maybe you're in your house. Maybe you're at the office. Get your emails done. Get up and dance. Clean the kitchen. Whatever you want, whatever your heart desires. Go into the networking space. Connect with people. Toggle back and forth. Try this little experiment today, y'all. See how many things you can notice that are positive, big and small. If you notice something negative, consider it to be irrelevant to your quest. Watch what happens when you make this your focus for the day. You are likely to be in a good mood and have an awesome day, y'all. Positive affirmations, let's go. Rosa, what's up?
Hoje é dia de sol, alegria de coió, curtir o verão.
Yeah. faz a senha do GT Decoração. Hoje é um dia de sol, alegria de xodó, meu TV de verão.
It. Leave it alone. You know what I'm saying? If you gotta force it, leave it alone. Relationships, friendships, even conversations, just leave it. What is meant to be will be. Don't you dare dim your light to make others feel comfortable. You feel me? Come on.
Safe day to rest. I must say something strange. Situation is, let's cure it cause we're running out of time. It's all so hard. Relationships they seem from the start. It's all so heavy. The love is not to get from the heart. Check it out.
Today is a day of happiness and peace. I'm grounded and centered. I'm grateful for my beautiful life that is filled with many blessings. Say that to yourself, y'all. I move through my day with consciousness, grace, and love. It's Thursday. I know y'all got a lot going on, as I do. You're just doing your best. Y'all. Let me know in the chat. Come on. This is your Greenlining radio station in full effect, y'all. Listen, y'all. If you pay attention to the patterns of your life, if you pay attention to the patterns of your life, you'll realize everything always works out. Everything always takes you to a greater destination. You always grow, and the things you think you can't survive, you somehow divinely make it through. And that is life. Always remember that. Whatever struggles you have, you're gonna make it through, y'all.
Imagínate, tú y yo en la playa, la arena, el mar, el sonido de las olas recorriendo todo tu cuerpo. Bésame y baila conmigo.
La base. Ya no tengo nada más que decir. Para decirlo hace falta muchas clases.
Y tú que te duro te marea. Hasta tu mamá le tararea. Que manda que me tire la mala. Si jara que me tira la buena.
Yo, check it. The older I get, the more I want to simplify my life and get rid of the clutter. I don't know about you, but the older I get, I'm over here looking at clutter and I'm like, I want to get this out of my house and out of my life. And I don't go anywhere or do anything I don't want to. And you got to say this to yourself, and I only spend time with people who enrich my life, not the ones who drain it, y'all. Come on.
Make it take my name.
Surround yourself around beautiful people that celebrate you and love you, y'all. Come on. For those of y'all that are with me and you haven't gone and networked a little, why not go into that tab and network just a little? Come on. Every time you wake up and ask yourself, what good things am I going to do today? Remember that when the sun goes down at sunset, it will take a part of your life with it. So I'm hoping you make today the best it can be. Natalie! Who's gonna take me there? Let me know in the chat. Come on. Won't you take me to funky town? Let's keep it funky, y'all. Won't you take me to funky town? Come on, Perry. To love, I will find the goodness in all things. I will bask in positivity and deny negative thoughts. I am capable of amazing accomplishments, but I'm grateful for all I've achieved thus far. Where you at? Greenlining Institute, second of a three-part series. Let's go! Come on! Adelaida! Come on! Don't you know you? Don't you know you? Come on, y'all! Don't you know you? Sing it! Oh, oh, oh! Sing it, y'all! Oh, 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 oh you. Come on, Carrie. For yourself, do it for you.
Get your shoulder, your dance, make some noise, move your feet in your head. Oh, you got a chance, you wanna get up and give God all you can. Get your shoulder, your dance, make some noise, move your feet in your head. Oh, you got a chance, you wanna get up and give God all you can.
Oh, 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 oh.
Yo.
Everybody now, oh, 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 oh. Don't you know girl? Don't you know girl? Don't you know girl? Don't you know girl?
Get your shot of your dance, make some noise, move your feet in your head.
Christina, what's up?
Get your shot of your dance, make some noise, move your feet in your head. While you got a chance, you wanna get up and give God all you can.
Now let the people say,
hallelujah.
Everybody say,
come on, y'all.
Let the people say,
hallelujah.
All the people say,
hey.
Everybody say,
where you at? Beautiful people, everything in your life works out in your favor once you take care of yourself. Hydrate, stretch, sleep enough, connect with your lover, eat healthy food, and take care of your mind and body no matter what. No matter what.
I need a-
Hey,
Javi, come on. Girl, at the end of the get on now. Javi, 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 come on. Girl, at the end of the get on now. Javi, 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 come on. Girl, at the end of the get on now.
Who's clapping with me? Come on.
Javi, Javi, girl, at the end of the get on now. Javi, 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 come on. Girl, at the end of the get on now. Javi, 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 come on. Girl, at the end of the get on now.
My beautiful people, your thoughts are so powerful. Every single thought you have is heard and noted by the universe. Those thoughts are creating your reality. Knowing this, keep your thoughts as positive as possible because you deserve the future of your dreams, y'all. Come on. Gabriela, Dana.
Que la distancia ya no se va. Yo recordándome de ti, que no me diga, ay Paraguay, ay, ay, ay.
Hey,
yo vi, yo va, cada día yo te quiero más. Yo vi, yo vi.
Let's go! My beautiful people, prioritize your peace of mind. I'll say it again. Prioritize your peace of mind. Practice being calm when you feel like you're being challenged or tested. Take a few hours or days for things to clear out. Be emotionally intelligent so you can be in the right state of mind to make better choices. Y'all have a beautiful rest of your day. Thank you for staying with us. We'll see you next time, September 22nd. I'll be here at, of course, Greenlining Institute. Now and next speaker series. We'll see you then. Have a beautiful rest of your day, y'all. Bye-bye.